Western District of New York is now in session. The Honorable William M. Scrutiny, Chief Judge, presiding.
All right, good morning, everyone. Okay, please have a seat. Judge Egan, if you want to come on up into the jury box, please. All right, probably nobody noticed that Judge Egan was 2 minutes late.
Thank you, I don't know, just copy right in. Sorry, everyone.
All right, good morning, everyone. It really is a pleasure of mine to welcome all of you on this spectacular morning in downtown Buffalo to our pride and joy, the Robert H. Jackson United States Courthouse. I hope you like it. I hope you will have a very positive experience today. It's a particularly relevant discussion case. It can be a very positive. My name is William Scrutiny. I'm the chief. Our other federal judge of what is known as the Western, probably more, most of you know more about, for we're the seventh busiest district. Our jurisdiction extends to, and on the west, the Pennsylvania, in that area, sort of that group, not only for every day. So we're very happy to have you here. Judges have the honor of hosting the and they are here presenting their second annual James Otis Lecture to commemorate and recognize Constitution Day. James Otis, by the way, if you haven't studied him, he was an American patriot, very active during the time that our original colonies were struggling for independence from England or Great Britain back in those early colonial days. It was in September in 1787, none of the judges were there at the time, just so you know, that the founders, the 39 state delegates, voted to approve the draft of our United States Constitution. So what an important day it is today, Constitution Day. I mean, it's a couple days removed, but you know, we're celebrating Constitution Day. And of course, our Constitution, all 4,543 words of it, and all of them, by the way, are inscribed in what we call the curtain wall. That's the front wall of the pavilion area where you entered today. You'll find all of those words of the Constitution seven times over on the pavilion wall of this building. And while our Constitution, in certain respects, is an imperfect document, it is the product of a hard-fought series of compromises that were reached over the course of several heated, both in temperament and in temperature, summer months in Philadelphia in 1787. And that Constitution document that guides us every single day in the attempt to administer justice fully and fairly is a changing and changeable document. There are, as you probably know, 27 amendments, but it is in those compromises, especially those which distribute control between the three branches of government, that gives this document its persevering power. And it is Article 3 of the Constitution that creates the judiciary, that Chief Judges, Justice John Roberts in Washington, D.C. of the United States Supreme Court, who was born in Hamburg, New York, said that Article 3 is the secret to its success, meaning the judiciary's success. Because it invests in us, the judiciary, a branch unconnected with the other two branches, the first branch and the second branch of government, they're political branches. It invests in us, Article 3 does, the power to interpret the United States Constitution. And that interpretation, even if the other two branches disagree, even if they think the decision is dead wrong, that decision is binding on them. That's what Article 3 empowers the third branch of government to do. So on this day, really 2 centuries removed, we celebrate this enduring, guiding document that has given life to and sustained our great nation. Today, specifically, we are going to celebrate the 14th Amendment, that which affords all citizens equal protection of the laws. It was that provision which guided the United States Supreme Court 60 years ago, when a unanimous Supreme Court, including the ailing Robert H. Jackson, and you know this is the Jackson Courthouse, he was an Associate Justice of the United States Supreme Court, and signed the opinion, that unanimous opinion, from his deathbed, basically. And the court ruled in that landmark case of Brown versus Board of Education of Topeka, Kansas, that segregation by race in public schools was unlawful, that separate educational facilities are inherently unequal. Today, we celebrate that ruling in a building named after one of its authors and driving forces. And as you will hear later, Robert Jackson was born only a few miles away from here, near Jamestown, New York, and practiced law right here in Buffalo. I think you're going to agree at the end of the day that it all adds up to being a special day. And I know a lot of hard work made today possible, work from the administration at your schools, we thank them, your teachers, we thank them, and court and technical staff, hard work also came to play today with respect to the speakers that you are about to hear, whose discussions I am certain will prove insightful and enlightening. You will hear today from Patrick J. Maloney, president of the Buffalo chapter of ABOTA, and Gregory L. Peterson, co-founder of the Justice Jackson Center in Jamestown. We also have the pleasure of hearing from our keynote speaker, Professor Rick Sue, who's in the jury box there, by the way. We put him in there first so he couldn't leave early. He'll present an energetic, I'm sure, and engaging discussion of Brown versus Board of Education. I also have the pleasure of informing you of an extra special event. You will hear today from the judge who presided over the desegregation cases in Buffalo, Judge John T. Curtin. You will get a firsthand account of those pivotal, controversial times from the judge himself. We owe a great deal of thanks to Judge Curtin and his staff, and to Michael Perley. You will hear from Michael. He is the driving force with respect to Constitution Day, not only last year, but this year. We thank you, Michael, for all of your efforts. Mike did an expert job in conducting the interview of Judge Curtin and really putting this entire program together. So we're about to start. I do want to introduce you to the various judges that are here. You will meet some of them at the session afterwards, the noontime lunch session. But Judge Hugh Scott, you will hear from Judge Scott, Judge Leslie Fascio, who's in the center right in front of me, and Judge Jeremiah McCarthy. You've already met Judge Susan Egan, who is here in the jury box, and she's from our state court system. So we will all be participating in today's proceedings, and I hope you really do enjoy it. Much awaits you this morning and this afternoon, so I'm not going to take up any more time. I eagerly invite now Patrick Maloney, president of ABOTA, to our lectern to get our program started. Patrick, if you would, please.
Thank you, Your Honor.
While Patrick's going there, I almost forget my courtroom deputy. That's Mary Labazetta, and she opened the official court proceeding this morning.
Judge Gretton, judges, ladies and gentlemen, thank you and welcome. My name is Pat Maloney. I am the president of the Buffalo chapter of the American Board of Trial Advocates, or ABOTA. We are the sponsor of the festivities here today, the second annual James Otis Lecture. ABOTA is an organization comprised of over 6,000 civil trial attorneys who represent both plaintiffs and defendants in the United States. To be considered for membership, you must have tried a minimum of 20 civil cases to verdict before a jury. At that point, you can be nominated by your chapter for membership if you meet the standards of ethics and civility required by our organization. There are 98 chapters across the country, and the Buffalo chapter has 32 members. Now, I got to be honest with you, nowadays being president of the group of lawyers is not something a lot of people aspire to. Lawyers don't always enjoy a great reputation today, a lot of it our own doing. But I'm here to defend us just a little bit and have you think about some things that may not jump out right to you right away about lawyers. I understand we have some ladies from BuffSem here today, is that correct? Raise your hand. Did any of you participate in Hornet Jacket Day last week? Raise your hand. Thank you. Having graduated two daughters from BuffSem, I am very familiar with Hornet Jacket festivities. But for those of you that may not be, it is a day dedicated to spirit building at the school. And among other activities, it often involves loud, sometimes very loud, vocal gatherings both inside and outside the school, including a quasi-parade in some years. Now, I live about half a block from the school, and you always know when it's Hornet Jacket Day. Ladies, when you participated in those activities, you may not have realized, but you are exercising some pretty fundamental rights that are extremely important in this country. The right to free speech, the right to public assembly, the right to a public demonstration. These are rights that are not guaranteed in all countries. They're not guaranteed in a lot of countries. But in this country, the Constitution and the Bill of Rights guarantee you all those fundamental rights. I submit to you, though, that the Constitution and the Bill of Rights are just pieces of paper. Now, they're very important pieces of paper, but they are just pieces of paper. They alone do not guarantee you anything. Those rights are protected each and every day by lawyers. Lawyers who fight for those fundamental rights and protections right down to this very day in courtrooms all across America. The founders of this country knew it was tremendously important to protect its citizens from the power government could exercise. Which brings us to James Otis. James Otis was a 37-year-old lawyer who on February 25, 1761, argued before the Supreme Court of Judicature in the Massachusetts Bay Colony sitting in Boston. Otis argued that the renewed writs of assistance, which allowed the Crown or its agents to search any subject's home or property for contraband or untaxed goods without judicial oversight or just cause to believe a crime had been committed, violated the natural rights of Englishmen. His argument was founded on the principle that not even the king was above the law that protected all rights of citizens. It was the first time this argument had ever been made in a court of law. Now, if any of you had ever had to give a speech or to get up and speak or argue before anybody, you know how difficult it could be and how minutes can seem like hours. Trust me, it's not easy. I make a living doing it, and I worked for several hours yesterday to have a 3-minute speech here today. Well, James Otis argued his point for 5 hours. I want you to think about that when you leave today. With all you've been through, with all you're going to see, with the lectures, with the video, with the demonstration, with Professor Sue's speech, with lunch, with everything else, when you leave, if James Otis started right now, he would still have 2.5 hours left of his argument. Now, he argued for 5 hours, and he lost. Now, Judge Scretany, and I'm willing to bet all these judges, would say any lawyer that argues for 5 hours deserves to lose. But history will tell us that although he lost, he made his point. His arguments would prevail with the people in the New World. He lost on written instructions to the court from London that he was to lose that argument. But in the back of the courtroom the day of Otis's argument was a young lawyer named John Adams. He was so enraptured with the oration that he started taking down every word of Otis's argument. When he could no longer keep up, he summarized the remainder of the 5-hour argument. Adams left the courtroom that day convinced that all who heard Otis were prepared to take up arms against the writs. Years later, Adams attributed Otis's argument at the beginning of the revolution as the beginning of the revolutionary movement, writing, "Then and there, the child independence was born." It has been said that his argument laid the foundation for the Fourth Amendment, the Bill of Rights, and more broadly, the notion of limited government based on reason and the rule of law. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you that even today, if you want to have a public gathering, if you want to have a demonstration, if you want to exercise your right to free speech, you can do that because a lawyer has your back. Before Judge Scratney gives me the hook, I must thank a few people here today. First, Judge Scratney, our host. As you have heard, this is one of the busiest federal courts in the country. Judge Scratney has dedicated this time, as asked the other judges to be here. We want to thank him, first and foremost, for having us here today. Judge Scratney's staff, Jeff Bagley, Jennifer Phillips, Andrew Moeller. Judge Curtin, who you will hear in the interview on the TV. Janet Curry, legal assistant, and William Shelkoff, his clerk. Greg Peterson in the Jackson Center, and our moderators, Magistrate Scott, Magistrate Fascio, Magistrate McCarthy, Supreme Court Justice Sywick, City Court Justice Susan Egan, and Joanne Galvin, Chair of the Bar Association Federal Practice Committee. The teachers, Doug Hopkins from Buffalo Seminary, Lynn Garcia from Hutch Tech, and Eric Simonson from Middle Early College. Mike will have a few more thank yous to do, but we'll save those for lunch. But I would be remiss if I did not personally thank Mike Perley for all of the time and effort he put in. Anything that is good about this program is up to Mike. If there's any problem, you can blame me. But all that's done good, this program was done by Mike Perley. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
My name is Greg Peterson. I am one of the co-founders of the Robert H. Jackson Center, and your honors, thank you for permitting me the privilege of speaking today. And to all our fellow students of the law, and we are all students of the law, today's a pivotal day in the history of honoring the activities of the United States Supreme Court, for it was on May 17, 1954, a little more than 60 years ago, the Supreme Court of the United States decided the most memorable decision in its history. The court unanimously ruled that separate educational facilities are inherently unequal and that segregated schools were unconstitutional. The case was Brown versus Board of Education of Topeka, Kansas, and it involved, among others, a young student from Topeka, Kansas, named Linda Brown, and we will actually hear from her shortly. The case involved the overruling of an 1896 case entitled Plessy versus Ferguson. There, Homer Plessy, a black, was required to ride in a segregated streetcar. The Supreme Court ruled that it was constitutional to treat races differently so long as it was equal. Hence, the creation of the infamous doctrine known as separate but equal. That's the backdrop. What most folks don't know, there's a whole Western New York connection. The attorney for Homer Plessy, a case down in Louisiana, was Albion Torje, who was living in Mayville, New York, Chautauqua County. And he argued that the Constitution was, in fact, colorblind, and that, in fact, justice is pictured blind, and her daughter, the law, ought to at least be colorblind. He argued that it provides no allowance for distinctions based on race. This was in 1896. He lost. And hence, a doctrine was implemented through the Supreme Court, separate but equal, which created the Jim Crow laws, which created a lot of things which you study currently in your American history. Fast forward, there was an associate justice of the United States Supreme Court named Robert H. Jackson, who was born just on the other side of Jamestown, New York, and Pennsylvania, and moved to Jamestown at age 5 and became the answer to the Jeopardy question. named the only person in the history of the United States to become a Solicitor General, Attorney General, and a Justice of the United States Supreme Court, and currently is the name which adorns this federal courthouse. In the 1950s, there was several cases percolating through the Supreme Court dealing with the issues of segregation, creation of separate but equal. And Robert Jackson, while Associate Justice of the Supreme Court, wrote his friends down in Jamestown and said, could you go and get the papers of Albion Tourge? Albion Tourge, again, the attorney for Homer Plessy, left his papers to the Chautauqua County Historical Society. They were there. So his attorney friends grabbed the papers, sent them down, including the briefs, the argument before the Supreme Court. And there, Robert Jackson wrote on a couple of occasions that those briefs he discovered was in keeping with the principles as it offered a sweeping challenge to the constitutionality of racial segregation, and that those arguments made by this Chautauqua County lawyer in 1896 are equally applicable today in 1950. Now, nobody knows for sure that whether those arguments had a great influence on Robert Jackson, but he read them with due diligence, and in fact, as Chief Judge Scretany indicated, it was our Robert Jackson who was intimately involved in formulating with Chief Judge Justice Earl Warren the unanimous opinion which overruled the separate but equal constitutional principle that had been held for many, many years. So here we are at the Robert H. Jackson Federal Courthouse 60 years later, celebrating the famous Brown versus Board of Education. But little known is, in fact, the connection of Western New York, from Albion Tourge, his papers in Mayville, New York, to Robert Jackson, also from Chautauqua County, and ultimately the decision which we're celebrating today. And I also here to, introduce a video which you'll now be seeing, hearing from the actual words of Linda Brown. Linda Brown was the named plaintiff and the individual involved at Topeka who was in fact denied admission to the school in Topeka. She came to Chautauqua County, to the Robert Jackson Center, on the 50th anniversary of Brown versus Board of Education, so I'm glad to share a brief vignette of her presentation.
Having us come in today to be with you and talk about Brown versus the Board of Education and our part in that historic case, and reminisce with me some 50 years ago when my family became part of Brown versus the Board of Education. It all started for me on a balmy day in the fall of 1950 in the quiet Kansas town of Topeka when a mild-mannered black man took his plump 7-year-old daughter by the hand and walked briskly 4 blocks from their home to the all-white school and tried without success to enroll his child. The child of whom I speak was I, Linda Carroll Brown, and my father, the late Reverend Oliver Leon Brown. Black parents in Topeka felt that the day of trying to enroll their children in the school nearest to their home was long overdue. Many were the evenings my father would arrive home to find my mother almost in tears because I would get halfway to the school bus stop, which was a 7-block walk from my home. I could only make half that walk because the cold would get too bitter for a small child to bear. I can still remember starting that bitter walk and the terrible cold that would cause my tears to freeze upon my face. I would return running as fast as I could. I had to cross a very busy avenue in order to catch the school bus, which would carry me more than 2 miles across town to the all-black Monroe Public School. These were the circumstances which so angered black parents. My father pondered why. Why should our children have to travel so far to school, facing unbearable winter weather, waiting for a badly overcrowded school bus to carry them some 2 miles across town when there is a school only 4 blocks from our home. Why? Why must I have to spend time trying to explain to my child that she cannot go to school with her neighborhood playmates, who are predominantly white, Native American, and Hispanic, because her skin is black? In the face of this discouragement, he, along with 12 other parents, met with the local NAACP and their lawyer, Charles S. Scott, a local attorney, to make plans for each family to try and enroll their child in the white school nearest their home during September 1950. After trying enrollment and being turned down, a suit was filed in federal court in February of 1951. During the following July, the federal three-judge panel heard testimony from my father, along with several of the other parents, who agreed that segregated schools for blacks were unequal. I, along with my father, had to appear in court, but unlike him, I was not asked to appear on the witness stand. The case was argued before a three-judge federal court in Topeka and was decided in favor of the Board of Education and its segregated elementary schools. In Topeka, the issue was not so much integrating public schools to improve the quality of instruction, but rather the inaccessibility of the neighborhood schools. Black people were able to live all over town, but could not expect to send their children to the schools closest to their home. At the Supreme Court level, the case was consolidated with similar cases and argued in terms of the psychological damage brought about by segregation in public education. Experts from the psychiatric community were pulled in to examine whether or not segregation, in fact, served to break a youngster's morale and block the development of a strong, positive self-concept so essential to educational progress. My family became lost in the turmoil of the ensuing years, years that scarcely touched us. We lived in the calm of the hurricane's eye, gazing out at the storm around us and wondering how it would all end. I don't think my father ever got discouraged, but at this particular time, neither I nor my parents knew how far-reaching this suit would become. During the next 3 years, while the now famous decision was in the making, my father was called into the ministry. He received a charge in the fall of 1953, and the family moved to the northern part of the city, where we became the first family of the St. Mark AME Church. I was transferred to the all-black McKinley Elementary School in North Topeka, again facing the same situation of having to walk twice the distance it would have taken me to reach the all-white school just 3 blocks from my home. Time stood still as the highest court of the land pondered over Brown versus Board of Education, until an afternoon in May of 1954, when I was in school, my father at work, and my mother at home doing the family ironing and listening to the radio. At 12:52 p.m., the announcement came. The court's decision on ending segregation was unanimous. My mother was overwhelmed. On returning from school, I learned of the decision, which at that time meant only to me that my sisters wouldn't have to walk so far to school the next fall. That evening in our home was much rejoicing. I remember seeing tears of joy in the eyes of my father as he embraced us, repeating, "Thanks be unto God." That night, the family attended a rally given by the local NAACP and held at the Monroe Public School. The following school term was so very different, but not for me, because I was never to benefit from the now famous decision. For during the 54 school term, I entered junior high school, which was already on an integrated basis, as were the high schools in the city. Integration in the city in the fall of 1954 went very smoothly. It seemed as though blacks and whites had been going to school together for years. Neither I nor my family suffered the abuse or racial strife that marked integration in the latter 50s and early 60s in so many parts of the country. We were very fortunate, my father would often say. He believed very strongly that God would move people to do the right thing. The latter 50s found my family living in Springfield, Missouri, where my father held the pastorate of Benton Avenue AME Church. At this time, newspapers and magazines began to do follow-ups on me and my family because the significance of the Supreme Court decision, which carried our name, was beginning to really take hold throughout the country. It was during this time that I inherited much of the recognition that might have gone to my father had it not been for his untimely death in 1961 at the age of 42. If he had lived, I'm sure he would have become a strong civil rights activist in the movements of the 60s. Little did he know that years ago, when he stepped off the witness stand, he stepped into the pages of history. I didn't understand what was happening then, but it was clear that Brown versus the Board of Education was a necessary victory. It might have been a little flame, but it served to set off a mighty flame. To me, the impact of Brown is best seen in the increasing numbers of black professionals today. These are the people that after 1954 were able to have some degree of choice. This surely made a difference in their aspirations and their achievements. I ran across a quote in a new book by one of our black women authors, and her name is Mildred Pitts Walters, that I believe says it all. It is not the treatment of a people that degrades them, but their acceptance of it. Thank you.
Clearly a very moving and very important message by Linda Brown, and we're going to continue with that as our backdrop for further discussions. Greg Peterson, thank you very much for a very eloquent introduction. All right, you heard Linda Brown mention the case sort of progressing through the federal system until it reached the United States Supreme Court. You also heard the name Charles Scott as one of the driving force attorneys, not related as we know it, I guess, or understand it to Judge Scott, but he's going to tell us a little bit about the federal system and how a case, depending on where it originates, makes its way through the system until the United States Supreme Court gets to decide that case. Judge Scott, if you would, please.
Well, good morning. I just, you know, that's a moving piece, Linda Brown's speech. She referred to achievements and aspirations, and I think I'm a result of some of the work that she did, along with so many people who contributed their time regarding the war for equality in this country. I think I'm probably one of those people who, because of lots of circumstances, ended up a judge, and it was a perfect fit for me for these 30 years. I grew up under a TV, as you have, maybe your video games weren't TV, but anyway, I watched the civil rights movement unfold on TV, you know, live at 6, where people were put in police cars and paddy wagons, and you know, I saw the the fire hoses and those kinds of things against people who really were soldiers in that war for equality. And I remember as a young kid, I was wondering if maybe one day if I'm a lawyer, I could do something in a courtroom to try and help change these situations. And I was lucky enough to have actually achieved that. So when Linda Brown talks about aspirations and achievements, I think I'm a product of that. I really look at her effort, her father's effort, and all those people in the civil rights movement as having really changed the course of history and changed this country for the better. Well, first, Mr. Peterson eloquently explained the historical and personal background of the Brown versus Board of Education case. But what he didn't tell you is that this case began in a federal court just like the one you're sitting in today. You're sitting in a courtroom of the United States District Court for the Western District of New York, and the case that came to be known as the Brown versus Board of Education case was actually the name given to the five separate cases from all over the country, all but one of which began in a federal court just like this one. Supreme Court, of course, is the most important court in the land. The district courts are where much of the action happens. They're the trial courts of the three-level federal court system. In fact, the drafters of the Constitution themselves gave Congress the power to create these courts. Article 3 of the Constitution states that the judicial power of the United States shall be vested in one Supreme Court and in such inferior courts as the Congress from time to time ordains and establishes. District courts, in fact, all federal courts, are made up of federal judges nominated and appointed for life by the President of the United States, subject to confirmation by the Senate. This way, they can't be removed merely because they decide a case in a way with which some people may disagree. District courts, this one is no exception, are abuzz with activity every day. People are arrested, brought into this court for arraignment, hearings, and trials. We have important civil matters that are addressed here. A civil case simply means that it's not a criminal case where defendants can't be sent to jail. Instead, important wrongs are righted, wrongs such as segregation by race that was prevalent in the United States before the federal courts intervened. The person who initiates a civil case is called a plaintiff. And a plaintiff brings these cases alleging that the defendant or defendants somehow violated the law and caused some harm. It often is left to the court or the jury to decide if the plaintiff is correct. In fact, there can be more than one plaintiff in each case. If there are many people who believe that they have been denied some right by the same defendant, they can form what is called a class action and bring their claim as one claim. The Brown versus the Board of Education cases, plural, were class actions. Oliver Brown, a parent of one of the children, that's Linda Brown, who was denied access to the white schools in Topeka, Kansas, was the first plaintiff in his case. And so his name eventually became associated with the landmark decision. But there were actually more plaintiffs in each of these cases. Federal courts are powerful, but they are limited in some respects. The founders believed that the states should control and enforce the laws that control much of everyday life. State courts then deal with the majority of lawsuits brought in this country. Federal courts jurisdiction, which refers to the type of cases the courts have power to rule on, is limited by the Constitution itself to cases arising under the Constitution, the federal laws of this country, and disputes between citizens of different states. The Brown versus Board of Education cases were properly in federal court because they dealt with a violation of the 14th Amendment of the United States Constitution. Now, I also know that they are not infallible, and Congress knew this too, so it developed an appellate system to which litigants who believe the district court erred can appeal, and that's the process that was created. And like the district courts, which represent geographic portions of the country, appellate courts are split into circuits. Each hearing appeals from certain designated locations in the country, and in part of the country, appeals are heard by the, in this part of the country, appeals are heard in what is called the Second Circuit Court of Appeals. That court, by the way, handles cases from all over New York State, Connecticut, and Vermont. And for your information, there are 13 courts of appeals. That includes the Federal Circuit Court of Appeals. Now, you'll probably guess that all the plaintiffs in the various Brown versus Board of Education cases appealed their cases to the appropriate courts of appeals. But because the Supreme Court deemed the matter so important and so urgent, it accepted the cases even before the courts of appeal could hear them. This highest court, the Supreme Court, is located in Washington, D.C., and consists of 9 justices who hear cases from all over the country. The majority rules in this court, 5 votes is all that is required to dispose of a case. I'll let your teachers quiz you later on whether the Constitution requires that there be 9 members of the court. I'll give you a hint, it really doesn't. Generally, the court hears only those cases it decides that are sufficiently important, like Brown, issuing what are called writs of certiorari, which allows these cases to be brought before that court. Now you know what happened when the Supreme Court heard the case. The court consolidated the 5 cases because all centered around the same legal issue. And after the court heard oral argument in a packed courtroom, all 9 members, it was unanimous, all 9 members eventually issued a written decision in which they agreed that the old law, separate but equal, was inherently unequal. Segregation in the public schools had to end. It wasn't necessary to implement this ruling. Some of the public, especially in the South, it wasn't easy to implement this decision. Some of the public, especially in the South, disagreed and fought to keep white and black children separate. But eventually the ruling was enforced in all schools, including those in Topeka, where Oliver Brown's daughter went to school, were integrated. So that is the 3-part federal system, district court, circuit, and appellate court, and the Supreme Court. I thank you for your time and hope that all of you enjoy your day at this courthouse. I look forward to talking to you at lunch. Until then, I'll turn this program over to Mr. Perley of both Abota and the local prominent law firm of Hurwitz and Fine.
All right. Thank you very much, Judge Scott. I mean, that was absolutely instructive and very enlightening, and thank you for sharing your personal experiences with us. We appreciate it very much. Just as a very brief aside, I had the benefit, in a way, of the reverse portion of Brown versus Board of Education. Some of you know, perhaps, that I went to Howard University Law School. And I was part of a reverse integration program to integrate the almost all black law school. It happened to be probably the most memorable and moving and significant experience of my life. And I was there during the time that Dr. Martin Luther King was very active in the civil rights movement. And I was there when he was assassinated. And I was there when 14th Street was set ablaze and protest as far as what happened to Dr. Martin Luther King, and I met many of the political activists back then in days by the name of Stokely Carmichael, Eldridge Cleaver, Dr. Nathan Hare, individuals that maybe in your history studies you've heard about, but each had a personal experience that was invested in the aftermath of Brown versus Board of Education, and all of that combined activity, some of it as traumatic as it was, in a real sense became a positive driving force supporting our Constitution and resulting in a country now where the opportunity to be educated is not contingent upon class or status or gender or race. And with that, I'm going to have Mr. Perley take over at the podium.
Good morning, Judge Scrutiny, federal and state judges, students at Hutch Tech, Pinellerley College, and my daughter's alma mater, Buffalo Seminary. Good morning.
Good morning.
From the original decision of Brown versus Board in 1954 through the 1960s, the city of Buffalo, like many northern cities, including Boston, Massachusetts, had quietly resisted the mandate of integration. White students continued to attend essentially all white schools, taught primarily by white teachers. By the late 60s, the racial tensions in this country rose to a critical level, peaking in what was called the long hot summer of 1967. Its effects were felt in Buffalo, which experienced 5 days of civil unrest or riots during the course of that year. The issue of integration in the Buffalo City schools was brought to a head in 1972 when a lawsuit was commenced in this court, the Federal District Court for the Western District of New York, seeking to compel integration. The matter was assigned to District Judge John T. Curtin and was pending for 4 years before he issued his decision. While it may have been easy for Judge Curtin to determine that Buffalo did not comply with the mandate of Brown, he understood the real issue lay in its implementation and the necessary changes that would happen in the Buffalo schools following his decision. Judge Curtin was also aware that in 1974, a federal court in Boston had constructed and imposed its own plan on the school district there. The opposition to that plan in Boston was immediate, it was strong, and at times it was violent. So Judge Curtin adopted a different course. In his characteristic calm, deliberate, and thoughtful style, he reached out to the community and engaged its leaders in the process. The result in Buffalo was a plan for integration that progressed without incident. This past August, with the extraordinary help of Judge Curtin's staff and his chambers who are sitting at council table right before me, Judge Curtin was gracious enough to agree to talk to me about his thoughts on race relations in Buffalo and his role in crafting the school district that we have today. We spoke for over 45 minutes, too long for today's presentation. But today I am pleased to offer an edited version of that interview with Judge Curtin that captures, in my mind, the essence of this outstanding jurist.
Thank you, Mr. Perley.
Judge Curtin, good morning. On behalf of the American Board of Trial Advocates and the Jackson Center, I want to thank you for taking your time today.
I'm very glad to be here.
So if you let me, Your Honor, I'd like to start with asking you if you can remember when you first became aware of the 1954 decision from the Supreme Court in Brown versus Board of Education and what your impression was.
Well, I suppose I got it from radio news and newspaper commentary. I was not greatly surprised because I've been following the Supreme Court in prior years. And in many cases, they had begun to expand the opportunities for black residents to have access to community or municipal affairs like parks or swimming pools and other general accommodations. Of course, I was surprised to the extent that the Supreme Court seemed to lay down a blueprint which would be difficult for some communities to follow.
Judge, from 1954 until you were appointed to the U.S. Attorney's Office, I think you became the U.S. Attorney in 1961?
That's right.
In that period of time, in the cases that you handled in private practice, did you encounter cases that seemed to you to have issues that pertained to race?
Well, living in the community, I was aware that there are many instances where black residents had difficulty in getting housing or in being employed.
In your role as the U.S. Attorney, did you encounter any cases that to you took into account issues of racial segregation?
Well, quite a bit was going on. During the 60s, the Buffalo community, unfortunately, had several, I think they were noted in the press as race riots. Fortunately, it was not, they're not as severe as in other communities, but there was a general feeling, evidently, in the black community that they were not getting a square deal. And they made their feelings known by outbursts of violence.
If I could turn your attention now to the times...
And wait, Mr. Perley, can you keep your voice up, please? I have trouble hearing you.
Absolutely. I want to turn your attention now, Judge, if I can, to your service in the district court. You were appointed by President Johnson in 1967.
Yes.
And you began your service. And from my research, in 1972, the first case that involved the Buffalo City Schools was filed in your court.
I'll try to recall as best as I can the evidence that we received. One thing was that the school board, now we're going back to getting evidence of the board's actions in the 50s. They, for example, built temporary schools where they assigned all black students. There were very few black teachers in the Buffalo school system then, and they were always assigned to black schools, never to white schools. And for the most part, white teachers were assigned to schools where only white students were there.
As you began to formulate the decision in your mind, I want to ask you whether or not these words from the Declaration of Independence were in your thought process, and that is that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
Well, that phrase has bedeviled American society from the very beginning, because as you recall, in the Constitution, they had a provision where black slaves were counted, I think as 3/4 of a citizen, but did not have the right to vote. This was done to give the southern states where slavery was rampant a extra margin in the Electoral College when the president was going to be elected. Of course, this continued until the Civil War, when with the urging of President Lincoln, we had amendments which made slaves free men and gave them the right to vote. But unfortunately, the shadow of how our government enforced these amendments continued to be a bad one. So I wanted to get a plan that would work, and I needed the cooperation of many parents who probably opposed any integration. So I had a group of lawyers that I could count on to go to the schools and explain why, under law, we were obliged to follow the ruling of Brown. But we also wanted to gather the suggestions of parents of how best to carry an integration plan out.
Did you have any particular concerns or reservations about issuing your decision and how that decision would be received?
Well, of course I did. I knew that many of the residents in the city of Buffalo would not like the implementation of that decision in the Buffalo schools, because it would put additional burdens on them. Their And so I anticipated that something must be done to try to get them to understand the need to implement Brown in our schools. But I also knew that there were many practical problems facing us in location of the schools. In some instances, I foresaw that if new schools were started, perhaps we would have to bus some students. So I wanted to get a plan that would work, and I needed the cooperation of many parents who probably opposed any integration. I knew the judge in Boston very well, and I knew that he had a plan which came right from the top, and they didn't get input from the parent or citizen groups, and they had a tremendous amount of trouble, and I wanted to avoid that. And I thought if you gave people who were going to be affected by this, parents and citizens generally, if you got their ideas, if they knew that what they had about the running of schools could be heard, we would be able to make a smoother transition. And so that's what we tried to do. And I think we were fairly successful in our endeavor.
Your Honor, your chamber shared with me a letter that you wrote to a colleague. And in that letter, you tell your colleague of a visit that you had from an individual whose name was Darrell Harper. He had come to visit you because as a third grader, he was one of the first students that was integrated under your program. And he thanked you for your role in that program and told you that he had had a successful career. He had received a college degree, a law degree, and had served in the Army for 20 years. I
don't think that's unusual, because I do from time to time run into people who experienced going to the integrated school in Buffalo, and they were able to do something worthwhile in later life. And naturally, when I have those visits, it's very good.
Well, Your Honor, you should feel gratified for the role that you played.
Well, my role was only a small one. The role of the superintendent, the board, and the parents, and teachers and principals, and the community at large. Sometimes grudgingly, but finally saying, oh yes, we can make this a better community if we can integrate the schools. So I was very glad I could be a part of this process, which makes for a better community and a better country.
Brittany, if you'd come on up. Brittany has done yeoperson's work in assisting Mike Perley in putting this program together. She is a third-year law student at SUNY at Buffalo, and a very, very impressive student, I must admit. Brittany, if you would, please.
Thank you, Judge Scrutiny. How many of you guys struggled to wake up this morning when you rolled out of bed? Yeah, could kind of hit the alarm clock a few times. I'm a student too. I know how that feels every morning before class. It's really easy to lose sight of how important education is and how lucky we are to get to go to school, great schools, every day and be taught by such excellent teachers. And I think part of what makes our education so awesome, so much what these people we've learned about today have struggled to get, is incredible teachers who devote themselves to their students and to enrich our learning experiences. And I've had the privilege of learning from Professor Sue as a student at SUNY Buffalo Law School, and I think you guys are going to love hearing from him today. He has been an absolute pleasure to have in class. He taught me property law my first year, and I've had the opportunity to do research with him. He's a brilliant scholar in federalism, local government, and immigration issues, and he's got a great talk prepared for you guys, so enjoy.
All right, thank you, Brittany. Professor Sue.
So I want to first thank everyone, thank the court, thank everyone that invited me, but really thank you for being here. So in a few minutes, I'm going to tell you why I think the Constitution is a lot like my two-year-old daughter. And why that's a good thing. And no, it has nothing to do with the fact that the Constitution also doesn't like to sleep at night. That's something else altogether. But before we get there, I want to start with a more basic question. Why are we here? Why are we celebrating the Constitution? Or more specifically, which Constitution are we celebrating when we are doing the celebration? Now, we know we're here to celebrate Brown versus Board of Education, right? The case that desegregated the school, that said that separate but equal is inherently unequal. But the Constitution is also the same Constitution that created Plessy versus Ferguson that said exactly the same opposite. So when we celebrate the Constitution, when we think about it, are we thinking about the Constitution of Brown, or are we thinking about the Constitution of Plessy? So this question is kind of difficult, and I've been thinking about it a long time. And it's not just because I'm a law professor, right? I have students that come to me and they want to know, what does the Constitution say? And I have to give them an answer. I also ask this question because it's personal, because I'm a minority, because I'm an immigrant, because I'm a student in history. I know that it wasn't that long ago when I would have never, because of my race, had the opportunity to come to this country. Or if I actually had attempted to make it, I would have never been able to naturalize. It was just barred. I know that if I had come at a different time, I would have been able to buy my house in Buffalo, but I would have never been legally allowed to live in that neighborhood. And that if I lived in the wrong state, I would have been able to love the woman that became my wife, but I would have never had the legal opportunity to actually marry her. And I know that if I came at a different time, I would have been in a segregated school. That I would have been in a segregated school that was unequal and would not have the educational opportunities that I had, and to essentially become who I am. So you kind of get a sense of why these questions bother me, right? Because on the one hand, I am happy that I live in a better America because of the Constitution. But on the other hand, I know that the other Constitution, the other America, the one that would have excluded and rejected me, that was also an America based on the Constitution. So I thought about this for a long time. What is it about the Constitution that produces on the one hand Brown and produces on the other hand Plessy? And I looked at the Constitution, I asked it. Right? I looked at the structure, I looked at the language, and I tried to figure out what is a true constitution, what does this actually mean? And then I realized I was asking the wrong question. I'm trying to figure out what the constitution means and not looking at what the constitution does. And in fact, the answer that I was looking for wasn't even an answer. I was looking for a question. And the question is why? So I circle back to my daughter. So if you were to think about my daughter, if we had a one-on-one matchup, I beat her. Everyone. I mean, I'm bigger than her. She's like, I don't know, she's like this tall, right? I'm bigger. I'm faster than her, right? I mean, she runs right now. She's like, oh, I'm so fast. And I'm like, eh, I'm faster. I don't do it, but if we were, I can beat you. It's fine. And although my wife disagrees, I'm smarter than her. At least I think so. I felt smarter than her when she started asking me about a year ago, what are things, right? So she's like, what is this? What is that? What do you call this? And I'm like, I got this, right? That's a ball. Like, boom, right? And I started to feel really smart when about half a year ago, right, she started to ask me how, right? So she'd be trying to do something. She'd be like, show me, right? How do you do this? And I'd be like, that's Play-Doh. You want me to open it? Boom, right? Got that. But about a few months ago, she started stumping me. And she started stumping me because she does what every toddler does. She started asking why. And why is a tough question, right? It's kind of powerful because it demands more from you. It demands on the same point for me to sort of reflect back on why we do things, right? I do things all the time, but I rarely think about why. What's the purpose, right? What's the goal, right? Why do I do it? And it's a powerful question because it demands an answer. And it's an answer that I have to judge myself on, right? I can tell her easily. I can say, because I said so. Because that's just the way things are. But even when I say that, I know I'm ashamed of myself for saying it. I'm disappointed. It doesn't answer the question. It makes it go away, but it doesn't answer it. And it's tough to think about why it's so difficult, why I'm annoyed by it, right? When actually, at the end of the day, why is an inspiring question? And it's sad that we don't actually ask it enough, because at the end of the day, we do things because things matter, right? People tell you to do things, do that, do this, follow the rules. But we don't really want to do. We don't wake up in the morning to follow rules. We wake up in the morning because there's a purpose, there's a goal, right? That's asking why. And what I started realizing through my daughter was that's what the Constitution does. There are cases about the Constitution, but a true constitutional case is one that asks why. And why is actually quite important, right? You'll hear lawyers come and they'll say, the Constitution is about equal protection. The Constitution is about due process, or it's about probable cause. And I won't go through all the mumbo jumbo, I'll drill down to you. All those specific terms is essentially the power for you to go into a courtroom like this, and demand from the government or demand from somebody, why? Now they can answer, and maybe they can do it, but they have to give you a response. And that's unique, because governments do all sorts of things, and there's lots of different countries out there, and there's a lot of different countries in history. But to be able to demand from your government, to demand from the king, why, is actually quite unique. And that's unique to the Constitution, and it's unique to the United States. And it itself has a lot of power. Because it's not only the power of actually getting an answer, it's the power of forcing someone to consider why they're doing what they do. And they know that when they say, just because I say so, or that's the way things have always been, that in a way they will be ashamed, because that's not an answer. So when I realized that the question why is actually at the foundation of the Constitution, I started realizing why we celebrate Brown, but no one really cares about Plessy. And I don't mean that no one cared about Plessy because that was so long ago, it was decided 100 years ago, no one cares. Was that when Plessy was decided in its own time, no one really cared either. It was barely mentioned in the press. I mean, maybe people said, okay, I could continue doing what I did, but it wasn't something that they started celebrating 10-year anniversary, 20-year anniversary, 30-year anniversary. And the reason I realized that wasn't because Plessy wasn't about the Constitution. I mean, the justices came up and they said, I'm interpreting the Constitution. And it wasn't because Brown was unanimous, because Plessy had one dissent. Pretty much the entire court at the time agreed. The difference I saw was that Plessy was about the Constitution, but it wasn't a constitutional decision, because when the Plessy asked why, the court never answered. The court never dared to explain why separate be equal. Now, it wasn't because they missed the obvious thing that the dissent noted, that separate be equal was not about being equal, that there was no evidence that it was equal, that the whole point of separating blacks and whites was that the blacks got the worst deal and the whites got the better deal, right? But it wasn't that. It was that they didn't even question why separate to begin with. The most they could muster was essentially the bad answer I give my toddler, which is, well, you know what, that's just the way it's always been. In fact, it was the dissent, the one lone dissent that came out and said, I'll tell you why. This is a decision about racial superiority. It's saying that the white race is superior. And actually, to give him some credit, to give Justice Harlan some credit, he said, I am a racist. I think, actually, the white is superior. But I know that I can't say that in front of the Constitution. I know that's not an answer. And I say, when you look at it from this perspective, it makes sense that Brown came out differently. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't think people dislike Plessy. I think people heard it and they said, oh, this is a sigh of relief. But I don't think people were inspired by Plessy. I don't think it originated anything. And the opposite of Plessy was Brown. And I think it's because Brown was able to confront the question that the court and everyone else in America was not willing to confront for more than 50 years, if not 150 years. And that was why. You say separate but equal, and we could look at whether or not it's in fact equal, but why? Why separate? And what purpose does it serve? And does it achieve the goals of the Constitution? Does it make the world a better place? Does it form, as the Constitution say, a more perfect union? Does it advance justice? Does it do anything? Now, Brown answered that question, no, it didn't think so. And as a result, by asking that question and having answered, we came to a better outcome. And although Brown had its controversies that we will see, Brown inspired. Because it didn't just tell you what the Constitution said or how it does what it does. It actually tried to give a vision of America, a vision of why, that actually mattered more than the technical language. Now, I'll be the first to admit that the legacy of Brown was not easy. You heard from Judge Curtin, you heard from the other historical accounts that you saw, that it took a long time. Decades, if not still going on. The goal for desegregation, the goal for integration, that's still ongoing. And I think what's important to realize here is the third component of the question why. Is that in a government like the United States, where the government is we the people, any question to the government is at the end of the day a question to us. It's a question to us. When Brown brought the case to the Supreme Court, they questioned the government. In fact, they questioned them twice. The Supreme Court pulled on them twice. There's two oral arguments. But when Brown was decided and sent back to the people, the question was turned on America. And America had to now ask, why would they respond the way they did, either in resistance or in embracing it? Or why they voted the way they did? Or why they treated people the way they did? Or why did they find the community the way they did? And this question is not easy when you have to ask yourself that. Because it's easy to say, well, it's just the way it is, or because I say so. But the thing is, when you give yourself that answer, you know yourself that you're ashamed, and that's not a satisfactory answer. So how do I see this legacy? Because when the question was turned back on America, I would say that we're still trying to answer it now. But I don't see this in out of despair. I actually see a curtain of hope, or a light at the end of the tunnel. And the reason I say this is because when I started reading Brown, and realized it was about parents and students. And when I started thinking about the Constitution and realized what my daughter taught me, I realized at the end of the day that the Constitution is a Constitution or America or a world that I build. I try to build this world by asking why, but what I'm trying to do is leave a just world for the next generation. It's a generational struggle. Because at the end of the day, I can ask why, but it's hard. It's hard to change the way I do things. I know it's wrong, but it's hard to change that. So I want to end this talk about with a parable that actually that was developed by that I first read by Richard Ford. He's a professor at Stanford, and he was using it to try to explain why racial justice is just so hard to achieve, even though we all know it's the right thing to do. And he said, "Imagine this, right? Imagine that there is in fact a world out there, perfect, right? Colorblind, and not colorblind because everyone is white or everyone's identical and everyone does the same thing, but because they celebrate diversity and it doesn't matter, right?" You could be black, you could be white, you could be brown, you could be gay, you could be straight, you could be whatever, and they celebrate that. None of the petty bigotry that we have. And there's a train that takes you to that world. There's a train that takes you to that city. But here's the catch. Someone like me, I can't go because I'm too far gone. I grew up in this world. I've been tainted by it. I know it's a better world, but I know when I get there, I'll be a stranger. But there's a ticket for my child. My child that's already born and the child that hasn't been born, they can go. And the question he asks is, if he goes or if she goes, she or she will have a better world, but he or she will look back and not understand me at all. Because he won't have the taint. He won't have the corruption. And in some ways, she'll probably reject me to some degree, pity me for the bigotry that I have. And Richard Ford asked, he says this is why it's hard to have racial justice. But I say there's a little bit of hope there. Because I like to think that when I use the Constitution, when I ask why, what I'm doing is I'm building that city, I'm building that train. And when I go to court or when I support other people in decisions, I'm buying that ticket. And the only thing I hope is that when the time comes, when that conductor says all aboard for the last time, that my daughter would have the wisdom to turn to the train and I will have the courage to let her go. So I'll leave you with that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Sue, for those very challenging, incisive, and inspiring remarks. And thank you for being a part of this program. We deeply and profoundly appreciate that. Okay, this is what you've been waiting for, the end. All right, and you know, you've done a lot of clapping this morning, and we're going to adjourn for lunch and a discussion session. I want you to, with a round of applause, one more time, acknowledge yourselves, okay? And why? Because you are our future. You are our country's future. And we ask two things of you. One, that you remember. And two, that you ask the question, why? Thank you very much. We hope you enjoyed the day. A lot more to come. And you know, we're going to challenge you with the discussion. So be ready, get hungry, and we'll meet you down on the second floor. Okay? Thank you very much.